Hi there, Arjen from Lucas Fox here, and welcome today to a new format of videos. Today I won't be showing you around a beautiful property, not a villa, not an apartment, but I'll be talking to you a little bit about how to sell your property in the Marbella area. I've got my selling guide here with me, so I'll just quickly go over the points that you need to go through to sell your property here. We'll have some chapters lined up, and then you can just click on the chapter that you find the most interesting. But yeah, we'll start off with choosing your real estate agency. This is obviously a very important step. Next step is already the formal offer and the letter of intent to make a reservation. Then we go to the private purchase contract, also known as the ARAS contract. Then we go to the title deed. Then your property should be sold by then. And then we'll go over the documents that you need in order to sell your property and put it on the market. The documents that are mandatory, but also the ones that aren't mandatory, but are advantageous. The costs that are involved in selling a property. And last but not least, we'll give you some tips and tricks to make sure your property sells as quickly as possible. Well, step one in selling your property is quite an important step. It is choosing a professional real estate agency that you can trust completely to sell your property with and help you in that process. What does a good real estate agent or agency do? Well, you really have to look at the services they provide you with. Usually, the better service they provide you with, the better service they will give to your buyers as well. And get them to buy your property. A good real estate agent should give you a proper market valuation. He shouldn't just walk into your villa or apartment and just say, okay, I can sell this for 2 million euros. He should make a proper valuation and hand you that valuation, showing you how he got to that number. Then you can get to a good selling price, or at least an asking price. After they put a price on your property, the agency will make sure that they make professional pictures, professional videos in high quality. And when all of that is done, they will list the property on their website, but also on the biggest portals around the Costa del Sol. Something that a lot of people don't know is that agencies on the Costa del Sol share their properties with other agencies. So we don't only list it on the portals that goes out to the buyers or the end clients. We also have our own portal, putting your property on the market with other agencies. That way we become your selling agent and we work with the buyer's agents. So we just split the commission between the two of us and you don't get the hassle of it. After all this, after the portals and putting it online, we will also spread it on social media. What we use is Instagram, YouTube, TikTok, LinkedIn, Facebook. We don't use Twitter, but in general, those five are the biggest social medias that could get your property sold as quickly as possible. After that, we will also send out a property alert through emails. So to an existing client database, but also, again, an email to other agencies showing that we have a new property for sale and that you, as a buyer's agent, should take your client to our listing, which is your property. Your property will then also be included in monthly newsletters being sent out again to our existing database, but in our case of Lucas Fox, your property will also be included in monthly newsletters throughout the entire Lucas Fox group, which is over 30 offices in Spain but also in Portugal. Besides that, the property will get a regular feedback, so you will be updated every couple of weeks or every couple of days, actually, depending on how much viewings we have. But it's important to know that you have a personal agent taking care of your property, and your agent will always be there for any viewing that we have. The next step is explaining on well, whether you will work exclusively with an agency or non-exclusive or co-exclusive. One big advantage of working just with one exclusive sales mandate, or maybe two or three, which is called a co-exclusive mandate, is that you don't burn your property. Burning your property is kind of overselling your property. So having too many agencies sell your property might not come across as a good sign to the possible buyers. Because if, for example, 15 agencies have a mandate with you to sell your property, and all of those 15 agencies put their property on Idealista or some other portal, it might come across that you are desperate to sell your property, or that something is wrong with your property and that you really want to get it out as quickly as possible. So instead of having it with 15 agencies, I would advise, if you go for a co-exclusive or non-exclusive agreement, is that you just go with two or three agencies working on your property to get it sold. Another advantage of selling it exclusively is that if you have an exclusive contract, you will not get bothered by other agencies trying to get a direct mandate from you, because you already have that one exclusive contract. So nobody can try and get in between, because if they see that it's already with 15 agencies, they will want to become agency number 16 having that mandate, and agency 17, 18. So it can keep going, and it can get quite tedious if an agent is knocking on your, ringing your doorbell every day or every week. The next step in selling your property, after you have chosen a good realtor who does his work for you, is while having the viewings. If a buyer decides to put in an offer, you go to a formal offer, and a good agency will advise you to make a formal letter of intent. Because you can make an offer just by saying a price and saying, okay, we'll take it. You can even write it on a napkin, but you're always more sure that you will have everything formalized if you have a letter of intent. This letter of intent will go along with a good faith deposit. Usually, good faith deposit is between 6,000 euros and 1% of the buying price. And this is just a reservation fee. So at this moment, the property is not sold yet. However, it is a good way to show as a buyer that you are actually interested in buying your property. Once this gets accepted, we keep the reservation fee. So we keep it in a safe deposit account, or you can have the safe deposit account of your lawyer. And then it's up to the buyer's agent to do all of the due diligence to check if your property is completely legal and, well, has no limitations or anything going on. Next step is the private heiress contract. At this point, it is not required, but it should be best to get a lawyer involved, a lawyer who is in Marbella, because every area has its own ways of working. And for sure, a lawyer in Spain is not the same as a lawyer in Belgium or a lawyer in the UK. So you should really contact a lawyer that you trust here in Marbella. So the private purchase contract is, as the name says, a private agreement between the buyer and the seller, wherein the seller agrees to sell the property and the buyer agrees to buy the property. Sounds quite logical. Within this ARAS contract, or the private purchase contract, usually there is a penitential clause involved as well. And we advise you to always make sure this penitential clause is in your private purchase contract. It doesn't make much of a difference if you have a good buyer. However, you never know what happens. It's better to be cautious than to be sorry afterwards. So this penitential clause actually goes both ways. It protects you as a seller, but also protects the buyer. For example, if you sign the private purchase contract and you get accept a higher offer from another third party, this is not legal. You know, this shouldn't be done. And in this case, you make a mistake and you have to drop out of the contract. This means that you will have to pay back double of the amount that's already been paid by the buyer. So instead of gaining 10%, you will have to pay the buyer 20%. On the other hand, if the buyer signs the private purchase contract and then decides to opt out for a reason that you cannot control, for example, a buyer says he wants to buy your property, he signs the private purchase contract, and his wife doesn't want to move to Marbella anymore. This is not a legitimate reason to opt out of the sale. In this case, you as a seller get to keep the 10% down payment. So it protects you as a seller and it protects the buyer as well. On this step, on the completion, the buyer and seller should be required to be physically present to sign the title deed before the notary. What you can also do is give a power of attorney to a local lawyer, which should be the same lawyer that you already used to sign the private purchase contract, so that you give your lawyer the power to sign on your behalf. At this point, on the completion date, the balance of the purchase will be transferred to your bank account. The remaining balance means everything, including the 10% that already has been paid, but reduced by maybe the amount of mortgage that you still have standing out. Important, which documents do you need to sell your property? Well, first of all, your DNI or NIE and your passport of all of the property owners. If the property is owned by a company, we also need the company deeds and the DNI or the NIE and the passport of the administrator of this company. If you use a power of attorney, this obviously has to be there as well. And the original public purchase sale deed, so the original escritura, has to be present as well. Next up, we have the catastral certificate. We have the occupancy certificate. We have the land registry certificate, or the nota simple. The energy performance certificate is actually required now as well. This didn't used to be like that, but now you have to have a EPC, as we call it. The latest local property tax receipt, the latest community fees receipt, the latest utility bills, the copy of the community statutes. This is only if it's applicable to your community. The technical building inspection certificate, and the certificate with any outstanding mortgage amount. So these were all of the certificates or documents that you need to sell your property in a completely legal way. We also have some documents that aren't mandatory, but that can help you sell the property in a good and honest way. So what we have is the floor plans, always handy to have. Also handy for us to be able to sell your property. Any other mortgage related documents, a topographical map of the land, which is mainly useful if your property is somewhere in a hillside area, and the installation certificates for utilities, mainly if your utilities are not more than 5 years old. It's really handy to have those and to be able to hand those over to your new owners. Another point in selling your property is obviously, what will it cost me as a seller? Well, actually, selling your property, the most costs will go to the buyer. So the buyer has quite a lot of costs. However, as a seller, you have to keep in mind that you will have some costs as well. First of all, you will have your solicitor's fees and the commission to be paid to your agency. But you'll also have capital gains tax. You'll have the mortgage cancellation fees, if that applies to you. You'll have your occupancy certificate, which is just a small cost, but also a small cost for the land registry and to have your energy performance certificate made. Again, those are all small costs. And your local property tax. So these are just to keep in mind, but we will make a bigger video, a longer video, about all of these taxes and what to keep in mind when selling your property. So there you have it. These are all the steps you have to go through to sell your property. All the costs, the taxes, all the things you have to keep in mind when selling your property. On the other hand, I do actually still have a couple of extra tips and tricks to help us sell your property. These are tips and tricks that we can help you do as well, by the way, but just for you to keep in mind. So first off, we have keep it neutral and make space. So in general, the less clutter there is in your house and the more tidy it is, the more appealing it is to any buyer coming into your property and looking around and actually already feeling at home. Because if there's, let's say, there's toys of your kids laying around, that's not too bad of a thing. But it's your toys and your kids that are playing there. The new buyer has to have a feeling that he is stepping into his new home, not just someone else's home. So, first tip, keep it tidy and keep it neutral as well. Another tip I would like to give is add life, or make sure that you show life. With this, I mean, check if you have any dead plants. If you have any dead plants, get rid of them. So just make sure that you add some extra plants. If you have a terrace, or if you have a balcony, or even inside, just make sure that you have some nice plants, some nice life going around. But also outdoors. If you have a nice alfresco area, a nice terrace or a patio, make sure that you put some terrace furniture on there as well, with some, maybe a barbecue, maybe, I don't know, some extra plants. This just adds to the feeling of the house and the feeling of being welcome to a house. This really makes a big difference. Another, well, big tip actually is fix it up. Fixing what's wrong with your property will help you a lot in the long run, but even getting significant benefits in getting the best possible sales price. If there's anything that's not working, make sure it's working. Even if this is a shower, a toilet, just replace it. It might cost you a couple hundred euros, but it might get you a couple thousand extra in the actual selling price. Replace that broken mirror, get a new carpet. But even if you have an actual older property, it might be beneficial to invest some extra money before selling to completely renovate your property. And on the long run, after those investments, you will get a higher profit out of your property. Another tip is freshen up and lighten the mood. Freshen up should speak for itself. Before people are coming into the property, make sure that there are no ugly scents around the house. Just open up the windows, open up the doors, have some ventilation coming through so that you don't actually smell anything that shouldn't be there. If you know that, for example, a client or a buyer is coming at 2 p.m., don't start cooking at 1 p.m. Just some small tips. On the other hand, it might even help to add some scents to the room. Some chamomile, for example, some jasmine. Scents that calm your buyer when they come in. Because calm can also give a feeling of being home. The other tip, lighten up, is something that you can do before a buyer comes into the property. Open up the blinds, open up the shutters, turn on the lights, and this way you will have as much light, mainly natural light, coming into the property. Light means space. The lighter a property feels, the more spacious it feels. Another tip is clean house. You might clean your house the normal way, and your house might be even cleaner than usual when you just clean it for yourself. But sometimes buyers notice the most particular things. So make sure that all of the mirrors are clean, all of the windows are clean. But even really small things you might not notice, like light switches, even the property number, the house number. Make sure that's clean, It just gives you that visual aspect that just makes it, okay, this feels like a new property I'm buying. Next tip, define roles. This might sound quite logical as well, but it's really, you have to give a specific role to each room that you have in your property. You might think, well, the untidy storeroom is just an extra storeroom, but with some minor adjustments, it might become an extra home office. So that's a much more clear role for that room, a home office, instead of, oh, this is just the extra storeroom. This was the video about how to sell your property in Spain. By now, you should know everything you need to know about selling your property here in Marbella. But also, most of these tips, or actually almost all of those tips, apply to Spain in general. If you want to get more information, don't hesitate to contact us on marbella@lucasfox.com or go to our website www.lucasfox.com. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on Instagram on Lucas Fox Marbella, or even follow us on TikTok, also Lucas Fox Marbella. I hope you enjoyed watching. I hope you learned something new. And if you are a buyer, our next video will be about how to buy a property in Spain. Thank you for listening and stay tuned for more.